please.
Thank you very much. God for all. Lord is good. His mercy endure. Amen. We're glad to be alive. We're glad to be in this house today. Amen. We didn't read the scripture by hands, not the service leader's fault. It's a long scripture. I'm not going to read it all, but the message today will be taken from chapter 9 and chapter 10 of 1 Samuel. So 1 Samuel chapter 9 and chapter 10. So I'll be going through these various chapters, and I hope to go through it in a timely way. So I'm going to read a few verses from 1 Samuel chapter 9. I'm going to read from verse 1 to 9 to 8 and verse 15 to 20. And I'm just going to read verse 1 of chapter 10 because of time. But as I'm sharing the word today, you can follow through those various chapters and verses. So here it is, 1 Samuel chapter 9, reading from verse 1. There was a man of Benjamin, whose name was Kish, the son of Abiel, the son of Zerah, the son of Bechorath, the son of Aphith, a Benjamite, a mighty man of power. And he had a choice and handsome son, whose name was Saul. There was not a more handsome person than he among the children of Israel. From his shoulders upward, he was taller than any of the people. Now the donkeys of Kish, Saul's father, were lost. And Kish said to his son Saul, "Please take one of the servants with you, and arise, go and look for the donkeys." So he passed through the mountains of Ephraim, and through the land of Shalisha, but they did not find him. Then they passed through the land of Shalem, and they were not there. Then he passed through the land of the Benjamites, but they did not find them. When they had come to the land of Zoph, Saul said to his servant who was with him, "Come, let us return, lest my father cease caring about the donkeys and become worried about us." And he said to him, Look now, there is in this city a man of God, and he is an honorable man. All that he says surely comes to pass. So let us go there. Perhaps he can show us the way that we should go. Then Saul said to his servant, "But look, if we go, what shall we bring the man? For the bread in our vessels is all gone, and there is no present to bring to the man of God. What do we have?" And the servant answered Saul again and said, "Look, I have here at hand 1/4 of a shekel of silver. I will give that to the man of God to tell us our way." Verse 15. Now the Lord had told Samuel in his ear the day before Saul came, saying, "Tomorrow about this time I will send you a man from the land of Benjamin, and you shall anoint him commander over my people Israel, that he may save my people from the hand of the Philistines. For I have looked upon my people, because their cry has come up to me." So when Samuel saw Saul, the Lord said to him, There he is. The man of whom I spoke to you, this one shall reign over my people." Then Saul drew near to Samuel in the gate and said, "Please tell me, where is the seer's house?" Samuel answered Saul and said, "I am the seer. Go up before me to the high place, for you shall eat with me today. And tomorrow I will let you go and will tell you all that is in your heart." Verse 20. "But as for your donkeys that were lost 3 days ago, Do not be anxious about them, for they have been found, and on whom is all the desire of Israel? Is it not on you and on your father's house? Verse 1 of chapter 10. Then Samuel took a flask of oil and poured it on his head and kissed him and said, is it not because the Lord has anointed you commander over his inheritance? We say amen.
Amen.
To God's word. Hallelujah. The theme I'd like to bring to us this afternoon is God's divine providence. God's divine providence. And the aspect of God's divine providence that I want to look at this afternoon is how God orchestrates things to bring about his plans and his purpose. How God orchestrates things to bring individuals to their purpose and destiny. And we're focusing on Saul today. So divine providence is the governance of God by which he, with wisdom and love, cares for and directs all things in the universe. The doctrine of divine providence asserts that God is in control of all things. His sovereign reign over the universe as a whole, the physical world, the affairs of the nations, human destiny, human successes, human failures, and the protection of his people. The universe is not governed by chance or coincidence. God is in control. The Bible says in Psalm 103, verse 19, the Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and the kingdom and his kingdoms rule over all. Through divine providence, God accomplishes his will to ensure that his purposes are fulfilled. God governs the affairs of men and works through the natural order of things in order to bring about his purposes. Now, by way of introduction, if we were to look back at chapter 8, what led up to the events that began to unfold, Samuel was now old, and his two sons were not fit to reign in his stead. And so, therefore, there was no one, as far as the people were concerned, to replace Samuel. The Philistines were Israel's ongoing enemies. They were a constant threat to God's people. So his people wanted a replacement for Samuel. They wanted someone to judge over them. But they didn't want a normal person, they wanted a king, because they were comparing themselves to other nations. And so the request for a king displeased Samuel. And so it was what the people were actually doing, in fact, was rejecting God. And if we look back at verse 7, the Bible says, and the Lord said to Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. In other words, God was saying, give the people what they want. You know, sometimes God allows us to have our way. He sees the end from the beginning, but he just allows us to go on in the hope that we learn from our mistakes. But God is a God of mercy, God is a God of love, God is a God of compassion. And in asking for a king, as I said before, the people were rejecting God. But God does not reject his people. Now, in chapter 9 and verse 16 there, it says, for I have seen my people, because their cry has come up to me. This is very similar to Exodus chapter 3, when the children of Israel were in Egyptian bondage, and they cried out to God, and God said to them, I've seen, I've heard, I've seen, and I'm come to deliver. This echoes the mercies and compassions of Almighty God. Hallelujah. So no matter how much we step out of God's will, no matter how we walk contrary to his expectations of us, God never stops loving us. God never stops caring for us. One somebody says, although there are times continues to love us. He continues to lavish his love and his mercies upon us. Our sins do not dry up the fountains of God's compassion. He continues to show love and mercy towards us. For it's the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. His compassions, they fail up. They are new every morning. And great is his faithfulness. Hallelujah. So looking continually at in chapter 9, verse 3 to 5. The curtains open upon the stage and the events begin to unfold. Saul's father Kish, he's from the tribe of Benjamin, he's a powerful and wealthy man. He's a chief from a family of what was considered of the least in importance amongst the tribes of Israel. So verse 3 to 5. And the asses of Kish, Saul's father, were lost. And Kish said to Saul, his son, take now one of your servants with you, and arise and go and seek the asses. And he said, he passed through Mount Ephraim and passed through the land of Shalisha, but they found them not. Then they passed through the land of Shilim, and there they were not. And he passed through the land of the Benjamites, but they were not there. And when they would come to the land of Zuph, Saul said to his servant that was with him, come and let us return, lest my father leave from caring for the asses and take thought of us. Now, the donkeys were quite important during those times. They were used by the wealthy to transport goods, and they were very valuable. So we see that one day Kish's ashes go missing, and he sends the servant and Saul to go and find them. Now, I want us to understand that it's unlikely that this was the first time that the asses bolted and went missing. And I'll be following, looking at God's divine providence. So it's unlikely that this was the first time that the asses went missing. It's unlikely that it was the first time that Saul and the servant was sent to look for the asses. And I suppose that usually in a day or half a day, they would have found the asses. But there was something different about this particular occasion. They don't know if they're going to find the asses. They don't know when they're going to find them. They don't know how long it will take for them to find the asses. But God is working out and fulfilling his purposes. So the route took them back and forth across the hills and valleys of central Israel, and they were on foot. They were searching and asking questions about where these asses might be. And so as they neared to the end of the third day, as we have read, Saul knew that his father naturally would be worrying about him. Because usually they're back by now. Usually would have found the asses and have returned by now. So Saul is thinking, well, maybe that's going to start worrying about us and thinking that maybe we've got lost. And verse 6 says, but the servant answered and said, and we're bearing in mind now that it's the third day and they haven't found the asses, and it appears that Saul was considering abandoning the mission and returning home. But verse 6 says, but the servant answered and said, a man of God is in this town. People respect him because everything he says comes true. Let's go into the town now. Maybe he can tell us something about our journey or the journey that we have taken. Now, as we look at Saul about to throw in the towel, the servant just happened, and I'm using that just happened very vividly, okay? The servant just happened to remember that a man of God lives in this town and may be able to help. Can I? But I want us to look at some of the characteristics of Saul. He went on this mission of obedience. Now, he was a young person, and do a chore by their parent. The person might say, well, he's playing his PlayStation game, and he might say, just let me finish this level, and then I'll go. Or he's watching a film and say, well, let's go to the advert, and then I'll go. But for me, I believe that Saul got up and went with the servant in obedience, didn't waste no time. Because remember, these assets are valuable to the family. So he was obedient. He was also faithful and committed to the task. He was considerate, because remember, he began to think about his father worrying about him more than the assets. So he was considerate. He was also humble enough. So he had the humility, he was humble enough to ask a question and advice and counsel of someone who was only but his servant. Are you seeing that? In addition to that, we're seeing that he wants to give a gift to the man of God. It was customary during those times that if you went to see a seer or as we know a prophet, then you would bring a gift to the man of God. And the servant just happened to have a silver coin in his pocket. Are you seeing that? Now, interestingly, Samuel, being a judge and being who he was, used to travel around for the year visiting different areas and judging, carrying out his task. Are you still with me?
Yeah.
So he would go around the circuit of Israel between Ramah, Bethel, Gilgal, and Mizpah, and then return to Ramah. So Saul and the servant had no guarantee that Saul would be home. They had no guarantee that he would have returned by now. Verse 11 to 13. As they were climbing the hill to the town, they met young women coming out to draw water. So Saul and his servant asked, "Is the seer here today?" "Yes," they replied. "Stay right on this road. He is at the town gates. He's just arrived." Are you hearing? "He has just arrived to take part in the public sacrifice up at the place of worship. Hurry and catch him before he goes up there to eat. The guests won't begin eating until he arrives to bless the food." Samuel just happened to be back at Ramah that day because of a special sacrifice or festival that was taking place. Now, I want us to understand this, that they arrive and they see these women and they ask women for directions. They ask if the seer was there and for direction. Now, they say that women, I think they say that women are better at direction than men, is that right? I need to say that. Come on, I need to say that. And men are said to be people of few words. We just get to the point, don't we? We just get to the point. Now, as I read this, I pictured these women talking to Saul and the servant. They asked the question, "Is the seer here?" "Yes," they said. And they just gave the man a long spiel. They longed it out, the young people said. They longed it out. Now, for me, I think, it was giving a little bit too much information, but I also think that the women were kind of like this. Because Saul was a handsome young man. And I reckon they were just... So they delivered a lot of information. Let's make a choice. Okay, so they gave the information to the men. Saul and they made their way up to where the seer was. Now, I want us to understand that God is orchestrating things here to bring about purpose and destiny. Because God was leading, Saul was at the right place at the right time. When Samuel saw, according to the word, when Samuel saw Saul, the Lord told him, "Here is the man of whom I spoke to you. He it is who shall restrain my people." Then Saul approached Samuel in the gate and said, "Tell me where the house this still? Are you seeing God work things out for you? So Samuel tells Saul not to worry about the asses. Remember, 3 days ago, the asses went missing. So Samuel tells Saul, don't worry about asses. He says, as for your donkeys that were lost 3 days ago, do not set your mind on them, for they have been found. Now it's important to know that it was for the asses that Saul left home. Now, has Samuel not assured Saul that the asses had been found? Anything that Saul, that Samuel would have said to Saul, he would not take on board anything Samuel had to say. So it's important that Samuel gave Saul the information he needed. He got Saul's attention. Now, as far as Saul would be concerned, how would he have known about these lost asses? And now able to tell me where they are. So now I believe what the people have said, that everything you say is true. So everything now that Samuel will say, Saul is more likely to receive it. Are you still with me?
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you, Dan. Bless the Lord. So Samuel says, come and let us go. Now, the revelation by Samuel that asses were found, were now found, gave Saul a listening ear to whatever Samuel had to say, and also gave credibility to what he would have to say from here on. And I am here to tell you that you and your family, this is Samuel speaking to Saul, and I am here to tell you that you and your family are the focus of Israel's hopes. So what was about to be stored upon Saul was not only a blessing for him, but it was a blessing for his entire household. Because the idea is that his family will reign from generation to generation. Samuel was saying to Saul, because Saul means pray for or ask for. Remember, the people had asked for a king. So Israel had asked for a king to reign over them. Now understand that we too can be the answer to someone's prayer. Saul was the answer to the people's prayer. And we too have the ability to be answers to somebody else's prayer. And God is looking for vessels that he can use. Those who are clean and available and be useful for him. He will prompt and dispatch his servants to carry out his ministry. And I guess the question is, will we be alert or sensitive to his promptings when that time comes? Will we be available for the Lord to use us and to be an answer to someone else's prayer? And so we look at Saul's response in verse 21. Remember, he's only left home to find his father's asses. He never expected to encounter a prophet. He never expected to get anything spoken over his life or nothing like that. But his response to what Samuel said. And Saul answered and said, am not I a Benjamite of the smallest of the tribes of Israel? Now, if you are familiar with the story that there was war between the Benjamites and the other tribes of Israel because they did something despicable, right? You have to read to find out what they did. And so there was civil war, if you like, and the tribe of Benjamin was greatly reduced in numbers. So they became the smallest tribe in Israel. So Saul responds, and it was basically, why have you spoken to me in this way? What is it that you're actually saying to me? Now, remember, Samuel has come specifically for the purpose of this sacrifice. And what is interesting is that Samuel is expecting Saul. And he has asked the court to put away dish, set aside a dish for Saul for when he comes. So they eat and do what have you, and Samuel says to Saul, I want you to stay with me for the night. Now I want you to imagine what's going on in Samuel's mind at this time. Maybe he was restless all night, having eaten and received what Samuel has said to him, and maybe he tossed and turned all night. I don't know. But Saul came, if we look at Saul's family, Saul came from a well-to-do family. And we look at the characteristics of Saul. He was tall, he was handsome, he had the package, if you like. In appearance, he had the package. But scripture says that there was not a man among all the sons of Israel that was more handsome than Saul, that was taller than Saul. He was above everybody. You couldn't miss him. If you saw him coming in the crowd, you couldn't miss this man, Saul. And so, from an outward appearance, as far as we are concerned, because remember, Israel had never had a king before. And so all they had to go off was the other kings and how the other kings looked and how the other kings behaved. But what lesson can we learn from God's choice of Saul to be king? He may have had a full package, as I said, from an outward perspective. He looked the part, tall, handsome, young, strong. But this was not what qualified him. For God does not look at the outward, he does not look at the external, but he looks at the heart. For he saw someone in Saul that he could use to fulfill his purpose and be the answer to Israel's request and prayer for a king. In the book of Daniel chapter 4 verse 25, it says, the Most High is sovereign over the kingdoms of men and gives them to anyone he wishes. Verse 35 of Daniel 4 says, all the peoples of the earth are regarded as nothing. He does as he pleases with the powers of heaven and the peoples of the earth. No one can hold back his hand or say to him, what have you done? For God is sovereign. He is above all. Nothing happens by chance. Nothing is coincidental. God is very much in control. Verse 26 and 27. Then at the break of dawn, Samuel called to Saul on the roof. Up, that I may send you on your way, he said. So Saul arose, and both he and Samuel went out into the street. As they were going down to the outskirts of the city, Samuel said to Saul, tell the servant to pass on before us. And when he passed on, stop. Stop here yourself for a while, that I may make known to you the word of God. Verse 1 of chapter 10. Then Samuel took a flask of oil and poured it on his head and kissed him, and said, have not the Lord anointed you to be prince over his people Israel? And you shall reign over the people of the Lord, and you will save them from the hand of their surrounding enemies. And this shall be a sign to you that the Lord has anointed you prince over his heritage. Now, possibly having not slept very much the night before, he may have concluded, I'm not cut out for this. What do I know about being a king? What do I know about leading people? I'm too young. I'm just a wealthy farmer's kid. It can't be me. Surely something's wrong here. You know, there's a mistake. I mean, put yourself in Saul's position for a moment. What would you be thinking? Surely I don't qualify for something, a major task as this. And you may be doubting yourself and saying, surely this is a job for somebody else. But God doesn't make mistakes. 10, if you were to read that, you will see that between verse 1 and 8 is impartation, three I's, impartation, information, and instruction that he gives to Saul. Impartation, information, and instruction. And because of time, we can't go into all of that. Quickly going to verse 9 to 11. And it was so that when he had turned his back to go from Samuel, God gave him another heart. Maybe that again. And it was so that when he had turned his back to go from Samuel, God gave him another heart. And all those signs came to pass. Remember how Saul might have been feeling. Remember, he's seeing himself as inadequate. I am only but a farmer's son. I am young. I am inexperienced. I have got what it takes. All these doubts and questions would have been going on around in Saul's mind. But God gave him a new heart. Which means his thinking will be changed. His mindset will be changed. You know, he's no longer only a farmer's boy, but he is now the anointed man of God. He's now God's man for the hour, which means because the anointing makes the difference. Let's just sum it up. The anointing makes the difference. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You really need to read verse chapter 10. You really need to read that. But no sooner had Saul gone from Samuel than he felt another spirit coming upon him. A spirit of holiness, a spirit of wisdom, a spirit of fortitude to qualify him for government of God's people. God does not always call the qualified, but he qualifies the called. And Saul was called, and God anointed and qualified him. And when they came thither to the hill, behold, a company of prophets met him. And the Spirit of God came upon him, and he prophesied among them. And it came to pass, when all who knew him, when all who knew him before, saw that, behold, he prophesied among the prophets. Then the people said one to another, "What is this that has come upon the son of Kish? Is Saul also among the prophets?" So he was prophesying amongst the prophets, something he had never done before. But remember, this was now the anointed man of God. A new fire burnt within him, such that he had never before. So retrieving his father's asses was now the last thing on his mind. He now thinks of nothing but fighting the Philistines and addressing the grievances of Israel. He no longer thinks about anything else but making laws and administering justice and providing for public safety. These are the things that now occupy his mind and fills his heart. He experiences a new level of boldness and bravery. He has had a change of heart and a change of mindset, no longer only concerned with the produce and cattle, but having a heart of a statesman, a general, a prince. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whom God calls to any service, he makes them fit for such a service. Saul is now on his way home. And I'm trying to imagine how he's feeling right now. He's a new man. He's a new creature because of the anointing that is upon his life. But he's thinking about tomorrow. He's thinking about the future. And he's thinking about the people that he is now called to lead. And let me say this. Even though we may have specific task. Let's not forget that we are still human beings. And doubt and fear will still raise its ugly head. Yes, I know I'm called. Yes, I know I'm anointed. But I still feel somewhat inadequate. And I feel that this is perhaps how Saul might have felt. Now, confirmation of Saul had to take place. Now, the anointing upon Saul was a private ceremony. The people were not aware of this. And so, a means of making it public had to take place. And so verse 20 says, and when Samuel had caused all the tribes of Israel to come together, because Samuel had said to Saul that he would be coming to make this whole thing public. And so when Samuel had called all the tribes of Israel to come near, the tribe of Benjamin was taken. Then he called the tribe of Benjamin to come near by their families. The family of Machri was taken, and Saul the son of Kish was taken. And when they sought him, he could not be found. Even here, God's divine providence is at work. Because remember, Samuel called all the tribe of Israel together. And it was by lot, the means by which Saul was chosen. So they went from tribe to tribe. The tribe of Benjamin was chosen, and then Saul was chosen from amongst them. So they couldn't blame favoritism or anything like that. You know, it's important when you're making great decisions that people are part of the process. That way you get buy-in. So the people by this means were made part of the process. It wasn't done behind the scenes. It wasn't done in secret. They were part of the process. They could witness it and be a part of it themselves. So Saul, as you know, had already been anointed by Samuel. But as I said, it was a private ceremony. So Samuel had to, in turn, present Samuel, Saul, as the new king to the people. Now, they probably would not have accepted him had he just been presented. This is now your new king. It's likely that they would not have accepted that. And you would have had the rebellion and said, who do you think you are? I mean, who are you to reign over us, and so forth. So to avoid all that happening, proper process was undertaken. Now it would have been seen as, had it been a case of Samuel just presenting Saul to the people, they would have said, well, this was Samuel's choice. It's not our choice. But God allowed them to see that it was his choice. That Saul would be his man for the hour to lead his people. So there has to be a way of communicating this decision to the people, which would be recognized as being from the Lord, opposed from being from Samuel. And so lots were used. And even here, as I said, God was demonstrating his sovereignty and his divine providence. But we see here that when Saul was discovered, or when it was found that Saul was the man that was being chosen, he was nowhere to be found. When they called out his name, Saul was not there. So therefore they inquired of the Lord further if the man should yet come hither. And the Lord answered, behold, he hath hidden himself amongst the stuff. So Saul here is still afraid. He's still concerned that maybe I am not the man. He's still feeling somewhat inadequate, or maybe he still can't believe that he is the man chosen to lead and govern Israel. So he's in hiding. But when God gives us an assignment, it can't be for anybody else. When God has an assignment for you, it cannot be for anybody else. Only you can fulfill your specific assignment. So even after legitimately being anointed by Samuel, despite the divine signs confirming his And even after God's Spirit came upon Saul, making him the new king, when he came to stand and acknowledge that calling and be considered before the assembled people, he went into hiding. Everyone is at a loss as to where Saul is. And after consulting the Lord, it is revealed that Saul, as I said, is hiding amongst the baggage. And so in verse 23 it says, "So they ran and brought him from where he was. And when he stood amongst the people, he was taller than any of the people from shoulders upwards. And Saul said to the people, 'Do you see him whom the Lord has chosen? That there is no one like him amongst the people.' So all the people shouted and said, 'Long live the king.'" See, there is nothing wrong with recognizing our inadequacies. There's nothing wrong with feeling fearful or ill-equipped. But one should never run away from that which God has called us to do. Especially when you have confirmation that this is what God has called you to. We have a lot of people who are today on the run. They know that God has called them for specific purposes, and they are on the run. I confess I was on the run for a long time. Confession is good for the soul. But it's about, especially when you know that it's been confirmed. Sometimes you feel certain things, that God is saying certain things to us. But when God sends a man or a woman to confirm, this is what God is saying about you. This is what God wants you to do. You don't need any more confirmation than that. And then we should begin to walk in our purpose and destiny. So Saul was to be the king over Israel. He realized the economy, the enormity of the task. He was not succeeding anyone. Remember, there was no king before him. There was no period of handover. Because you know, when you succeed somebody else, there's a period of handover. They tell you what to expect, what not to expect. They tell you what to avoid. But there was none of this for Saul. He had no instruction manual. But the anointing makes the difference. The anointing makes the difference. Now, when we look, you know, everything I've said so far today is looking at God's divine providence, looking how God orchestrates things in order to bring about His purpose. Now, very often, things are happening in our lives. Things that we have no control over. And we ask questions after questions. Why is this happening? Why is that happening? And sometimes God leads us down some roads that we'd rather not be going down. And we will not always understand what God is doing. We will not always understand what God is up to. Because God is always up to something. God knows the purposes for which He has called each one of us. And He will do whatever it takes to bring us to purpose and destiny. And the journey may not always be comfortable. And we may not always be able to see clearly. And that is when we need to trust the Almighty God. And keep our hands in His hands. The one that Christ says, there is naught to fear in the desert here, if Jehovah is leading you. Because sometimes when things seem kind of crazy, we want to take our hands out of God's hands and say, "God, what are you doing basically? It don't make sense." Especially when we have an experience that we've never had before. But I'm a great believer that nothing happens for nothing. If God allows certain things to come our way, there has to be a purpose behind it. If God leads us down certain roads that are uncomfortable, know that He's leading us somewhere. Know that the experiences that He's allowed us to have are for a reason. Even if the experience is negative, even if the experience ashamed. And many of us, when we begin to walk in our purpose, we are able to testify to others. Because we see some people who are occupying some high seats, but they didn't get there overnight. They were on a journey. And if they share their experience with you, they'll be able to say to you, there were some difficult days, some painful experiences. We only see the end result, but we don't see the in between, where they were suffering, where they were struggling. Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. And we are living in a time right now where people are asking questions. So many atrocities and disasters are taking place around us, and people are asking questions. Now, this is not for us as believers to try and defend God, because people will be saying, well, if God existed, if this God was the kind of God you are talking about, then why is all these things happening? It's not for us as believers to try and defend God or to try and answer those sort of questions. It is for us to let them know that no matter how out of control that thing may seem in our world, our God is in control. And there is never a time when God stops being in control. This is a time where people need God. And it's an opportunity for us as believers to let them know that regardless of what is happening, God loves and God cares. God is an amazing God. He's an amazing God. And like I said, we can't always fathom him out. You know, I reflected as I was preparing and looking at God's divine providence. If we cast our mind back to 9/11, for example, and we heard during that time individuals who said, you know, that morning my daughter just happened to feel sick and I wasn't able to go into work. That morning, my car broke down. I was unable to get to work. That morning, the trains were running late, so I did not get to work. This is the hand of God. But then the question is, for many, well, what about the other people? And that's not because I can't answer. But I know that those people who didn't get to work, they have a testimony. And they can testify that had it not been for God intervening, I would have been caught up in that. But even in the midst of those situations, God is still. It's hard, believers, it's hard to grasp and understand. But when you understand that there is never a time that God is not in control, then you'll be able to better understand. So God is always at work, believers. He's always at work, orchestrating things to bring about his purpose. And as I said on Friday night, our nation is in a backslidden state. And I don't know, and I'm not saying that this is the case, but I do believe that God will use anything, by any means necessary, to bring people to their knees and surrender to him. And I would like to believe that with all that's happened, that Great Britain would say, God, we need you. Just like they needed him for one of those wars, they would once again say, God, we need you. We haven't got the answers, we don't know what's happening, but God, we need you again. I want to see Great Britain turning back to God. And if it takes these things to bring our nation to its knees, then let it be so. It sounds harsh. But if it's going to bring man back to God, I say, let it be so. I say, have your way, Lord. I say, Lord, let your will be done. Let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Hallelujah. Let me conclude and say, today there are many who are involved in various fields of secular employment, whether that be nurses, teachers, youth workers, social workers, cleaners, whatever it is that you are involved in. And this may not be, maybe a Sunday school teacher, a van driver, this may not be your specific calling and purpose. But what you're doing now is only en route to where you're going. What you're involved in now is only preparation for where God is taking you. Yeah. When Saul left home, the affairs of Israel and who would be king would not have been on his mind. It would have been last on his mind. He was just a wealthy farmer's boy searching for lost donkeys when he returned home as the anointed king of Israel, having stumbled into destiny. And even as God uses the losses of the family's donkeys to bring Saul to his destiny, so God will use the natural circumstances in our lives to bring us to purpose and destiny. Saul would never have come to Samuel unless he had lost something of great value that he could not find by himself. So God will use anything that it takes in order to bring you and me to purpose and destiny. So let us trust God, no matter what's happening in our lives. Let's make up in our minds that we're going to trust you, Lord. That we're going to keep our hands in His hands, knowing that He knows. We might not understand what's going on, but He knows what He's doing. And He has our best interest at heart by it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we bless you today. Father, we honor you. We praise you. We exalt your name. We thank you, Father, because you are a God who is in control, no matter how out of control things may seem in our world today. Father, we thank that you are a God of divine providence, that you orchestrate things in order to bring about your purposes. Father, we confess today that we don't always understand what you're doing and what you're up to. We also understand it's not always necessary for us to understand. But what we need to know, God, is that you are in control. And we thank you for that assurance today that you are in control, Father God, no matter how out of control things may seem. So, Father, when the going gets tough, when the road seems rough, Father God, may we continue to trust you. May we keep our hand in your hand, Father God. May we not pull away and try to find things out ourselves. But may we continue to trust you, Father. Father, there are many of us even in this place today whom you have a specific purpose for their lives. And even now, Father, things are happening in their lives and they can't quite fathom out what's going on. Or that they will be still and trust you, God. Father, there are those who are on the run even now, Father God. You have spoken to them. They've had confirmation, Father God, of your purpose for their lives. But they're still on the run. Fear has taken root. Doubt has taken root. Lord, you know, lack of confidence has taken root. And so they just feel inadequate and think that this position cannot be for me. And I saw you ran and hid, and many are in hiding even now. But I pray, God, that you will speak to those individuals today. Bring them to the fore in the name of Jesus. Father, the anointing makes a difference, and we know that, Father. And I believe that you have anointed many, but fear, oh God, still grips them. We come against fear today in the name of Jesus. We come against doubt today in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that there will be breakthrough today. That people will leave this place today beginning to reflect and willing to walk in the purposes to which you have called them, Lord. No one else. So may we arise today and begin to walk in those purposes. Father, we thank you for being the loving God that you are. We thank you for being the God of mercy that you are, the God of compassion that you are. We thank you, Father God. We thank you for life. We do not take it for granted, Lord, especially in this time in which we are living, Father. We thank you for life. We thank you for quality of life, Father God. In this moment, Father, we want to remember those, Lord, who have experienced disaster. They have many questions, Lord, that they are asking even now. Why? Why me? Why my family? Why my daughter? Why my son? Why my dad? Why? And Lord, we do not have the answers. But we commit those individuals to you today. Draw near to them, Heavenly Father. Would you throw your loving arms around them, O God? Minister peace. Minister comfort, Heavenly Father, today. Reveal yourself, Lord, today, O God. Have mercy. Have compassion, O God. Today. Many are struggling even now, my God. Many are heartbroken today, Heavenly Father. Oh God. Many have suffered so much loss. Many are still in shock, my God, traumatized today, God. Sometimes we feel so helpless, Lord, to intervene on their behalf. But God, bring them to you today. Our hearts go out to them today, Lord. Minister unto their needs, Father. Show yourself faithful on their behalf, O God. These are desperate times, Father. Desperate times. We need you now more than ever. Help us, Lord, as a church, as a body of people, that we will be relevant at this time, O God. That not only will we preach the gospel, God, but we will show the gospel. We will demonstrate it, Father, in our actions, Lord. We want to be a light in this dark time, Father God. So help us, Lord, that our lights will shine. That men will see you and come to know you, Father. This is the time to make you known, O God, our Lord. We want to walk before you uprightly and demonstrate your glory. We are carriers of your glory, Father. Help us, Lord. We need you. We need you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. Right now. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. Right now. We lift our hands to worship at your throne. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord.
And spirit, and we thank you, Lord. Thank you for thought their hopes and who face a new week, Lord, they will know that God has done something special for them. So I pray, Heavenly Father, that your anointing that breaks the yoke will work in their lives even now. Thank you again, Father, for this day. Thank you for your care. Thank you for your kindness and mercy. Thank you for your protection. Thank you, Father, that you're always with us wherever we may be. And whatever we may need, you are there for helping us, Lord. And we can certainly say today that we need you every hour. Thank you, Father, again in Jesus' name. Amen.
Something to note that were there any who made a commitment of their lives today? Anyone who came to salvation? No? Hallelujah. Bless the Lord.